Is what we expected, I think, said the barrister. And I'm glad the case is over. There was no particular sign of pleasure that his defence of John Turk, the murderer, on a plea of insanity, had been successful. For no doubt he felt that no man had ever better deserved the gallows. I'm glad too, said Johnson. He had sat in the court for 10 days, watching the face of the man who had carried out one of the most brutal and cold-blooded murders of recent years. The barrister glanced up at his secretary. "Ah, I remember, yes," he said. "You want to get away for Christmas. You're going to the Alps, aren't you?" "I can catch the morning boat now," he said. "I'm glad I've seen the last of that man's dreadful face. The description of the way the dismembered body was crammed and packed with lime into that..." "Don't dwell on it, my dear fellow," interrupted the other. "Such pictures have a trick of coming back when one least wants them. Now go and enjoy your holiday." Johnson took his leave. At the door he turned suddenly. "I knew there was something I wanted to ask you," he said. "Would you mind lending me one of your kit bags? It's too late to get one tonight." "Of course. I'll send Henry over with it to your rooms. You shall have it the moment you get home." Johnson dined at his club before going back to his rooms. He occupied the top floor in one of those old, gaunt houses in which the rooms are large and lofty. The floor below his own was vacant and unfurnished, and below that were other lodgers whom he did not know. In the hall he met his landlady.
"This come by a man from Mr. Wilbraham, sir."
She pointed to what was evidently the kit bag, and Johnson thanked her and took it upstairs with him.
"And now I must pack."
His employer had lent him the very thing, a stout canvas kit bag. It was not much to look at, but its capacity was unlimited. He shoved in his waterproof coat, his fur cap and gloves, and then on top of these he piled his woolen shirts. The dress suit came next, and then, thinking of the best way to pack his white shirts, he paused a moment. And as he did so, he heard footsteps coming softly up the stairs. No doubt they belonged to a late lodger. He went into his bedroom and packed his dress shirts as best he could. The kit bag by this time was 2/3 full. For the first time he noticed that it was old and dirty. He went on with his packing. Once or twice, however, he caught himself wondering who it could have been wandering down below, for the floor beneath was empty and unfurnished. From time to time, moreover, he was almost certain he heard the soft tread of someone padding about over the bare boards. Then an odd thing happened. As he left the bedroom, having just packed his recalcitrant white shirts, he noticed that the top of the kit bag lopped over towards him with an extraordinary resemblance to a human face. The canvas fell into a fold like a nose and forehead, and the brass rings for the padlock just filled the position of the eyes. A shadow, or was it a travel stain, looked like hair. It gave him rather a turn, for it was so outrageously like the face of John Turk, the murderer. He laughed and went into the front room where the light was stronger. "That horrid case has got on my mind," he thought. "I shall be glad of the change of scene." In the sitting room, however, he was not pleased to hear again that stealthy tread upon the stairs, and to realize that it was much closer than before. And this time he got up and went to see who it could be creeping about on the upper staircase at so late an hour. But the sound ceased. There was no one visible on the stairs. "My absurd imagination, I suppose," he thought. He went back to his packing. It was by this time getting on towards midnight. It is difficult to say exactly at what point fear begins, when the causes of that fear are not plainly before the eyes. Impressions gather on the surface of the mind, film by film, as ice gathers upon the surface of still water, but often so lightly that they claim no definite recognition from the consciousness. Johnson recognized that he felt nervous. Yet he could nowhere lay his finger upon the secret of this growing uneasiness. "Pure nerves, I suppose," he said aloud with a forced laugh. "Mountain air will cure all that. That reminds me, my snow glasses." He was standing by the door of the bedroom, and as he passed quickly towards the sitting room to fetch them from the cupboard, He saw, out of the corner of his eye, the indistinct outline of a figure standing on the stairs a few feet from the top. It was someone in a stooping position, with one hand on the banisters, and the face peering up towards the landing. The person who had been creeping about below all this time had at last come up to his own floor. What in the name of heaven did he want? After a few seconds' hesitation, Johnson found his courage and turned to investigate. The stairs, he saw to his utter amazement, were empty. He felt a series of cold shivers run over him. He almost ran into the light of the front room, but hardly had he passed inside the doorway when he heard someone come up the stairs behind him with a quick bound and go swiftly into his bedroom. And it was at this precise moment that the nervousness he had hitherto experienced leapt the boundary line and entered the state of fear, almost of acute, unreasoning fear. For some minutes he hardly knew what to think or do. Then he crossed the landing boldly and went straight into the other room. "Who's there? Is that you, Mrs. Monks?" he called aloud. "Who's there?" he called again. The curtain swayed very slightly, and as he saw it, his heart missed a beat. Yet he dashed forward and drew them aside with a rush. A window streaming with rain was all that met his gaze. He stepped backwards into the middle of the room, and, as he did so, something all but tripped him up. Turning with a sudden spring of alarm, he saw the kit bag. "Odd," he thought, "that's not where I left it." He did not remember having moved it. He went back to the front room, poked the fire into a blaze, and sat down before it to think. And it was here, just when he most desired to keep his mind and thoughts controlled, that the vivid pictures received day after day in the courtroom of the Old Bailey came strongly to light. The dreadful face of John Turk, the murderer. The white skin, the evil eyes, and the fringe of black hair low over the forehead. "This is all rubbish and nerves," he exclaimed at length, springing with sudden energy from the chair. "I shall finish my packing and go to bed." But his face was deadly white all the same. He snatched up his field glasses and walked across to the bedroom. And the instant he crossed the threshold and stood within the room, something turned cold about his heart, and he felt that every hair on his head stood up. The kit bag lay close in front of him, and just over its crumpled top, he saw a head and face slowly sinking down out of sight as though someone were crouching behind it to hide. And at the same moment, a sound like a long-drawn sigh was distinctly audible in the still air about him. At first, such a wave of terror came over him that for some seconds he could do nothing but stand and stare. A violent trembling ran down his back and legs, and he was conscious of a foolish, almost a hysterical impulse to scream aloud. "Who's there?" he said at length. The tones came out in a faint whisper, for he had partly lost the control of his tongue and lips. He stepped forward so that he could see all round and over the kit bag. Of course, there was nothing there, nothing but the faded carpet and the bulging canvas sides. He put out his hands and threw open the mouth of the sack where it had fallen over, and then he saw for the first time that round the inside, some 6 inches from the top, there ran a broad smear of dull crimson. It was an old and faded blood stain. He uttered a scream and drew back his hands as if they had been burnt. At the same time, the kit bag gave a faint but unmistakable lurch forward toward the door. Johnson collapsed backwards, searching with his hands for the support of something solid, and the door, being further behind him than he realized, received his weight just in time to prevent his falling, and shut to with a resounding bang. At the same moment, the swinging of his left arm accidentally touched the electric switch, and the light in the room went out. He groped furiously for the little brass knob to turn the light on again, but the rapid closing of the door had set the coats hanging on it a-swinging, and his fingers became entangled in a confusion of sleeves and pockets, so that it was some moments before he found the switch. And in those few moments of bewilderment and terror, two things happened that sent him beyond recall over the boundary into the region of genuine horror. He distinctly heard the kit bag shuffling heavily across the floor in jerks, and close in front of his face sounded once again the sigh of a human being. In his anguished efforts to find the brass button on the wall, he nearly scraped the nails from his fingers. The room was flooded again with light. There, close before him, bending over the half-packed kit bag, stood the figure of John Turk, the murderer. In a flash, Johnson realized what it all meant. The dirty and much-used bag, the smear of crimson within the top, the dreadful stretched condition of the bulging sides. He remembered how the victim's body had been stuffed into a canvas bag for burial, the ghastly dismembered fragments forced with lime into this very bag, and the bag itself produced as evidence. Very softly and stealthily, his hand groped behind him for the handle of the door. But before he could actually turn it, the very thing that he most of all dreaded came about, and John Turk lifted his devil's face and looked at him. At the same moment, that heavy sigh passed through the air of the room, formulated somehow into words. "It's my bag, and I want it." Johnson just remembered clawing the door open, and then falling in a heap upon the floor of the landing. He remained unconscious for a long time. When he woke, the wintry dawn was just beginning to peep in at the windows, and he managed to crawl into the front room and cover himself with an overcoat in the armchair, where at length he fell asleep. A great clamour woke him. He recognised Mrs. Monk's voice.
"What? You ain't been to bed, sir? Are you ill? There's an urgent gentleman to see you, someone from Mr. Wilbraham's."
Mr. Wilbraham's man came in with many apologies and explained that the wrong kit bag had been sent over the night before. "They must have brought you the one from the murder case instead, sir, I'm afraid," the man continued. "The one John Turk packed the dead body in. Mr. Wilbraham's awfully upset about it, sir, and told me to come over first thing this morning with the right one."
"Beg pardon, sir, but knowing your interest in the Turk case, I thought you'd maybe like to know what's happened."
"Yes.
John Turk killed himself last night with poison, immediately on getting his release, and he left a note for Mr. Wilbraham saying as he'd be much obliged if they'd have him put away, same as the woman he murdered, in the old kit bag."
"What time did he do it?" asked Johnson.
10 o'clock last night, sir," the warder says.
The Kit Bag was abridged by Robin Brooks. It was read by Matthew Marsh, and the producer was Clive Brill. It was a Pacificus production for BBC Radio.